ഇപ്പോൾ ഗവർണർ ആരിഫ് മുഹമ്മദ് ഖാൻ മാധ്യമങ്ങളെ കാണുകയാണ് അതിലേക്ക്
When I say that we even lack the guard for these basic things that we should respect our national institutions. And I would now that it is out, I want to draw your attention. I thought you are asking me about the language. Look at the language which has been used. As a Keralite, I ask you, how do you feel about it?
Very shocking, sir. It's the language is...
I don't feel like showing my face to anybody outside Kerala. This is the language which my vice chancellor, university, which is one of the oldest university, is concerned. Vice chancellor of that university is writing this language.
But I just learned that you are called VC Mr. Mahadevan Birla and asked that you should write.
I will tell you. I won't go into. I'm not confirming anything. I'm not denying anything. But I will give you enough idea. I call the vice chancellor, and you tell me what. Suppose you were in my place, what conclusion you will reach? I call him. I say that your former students are complaining to me regularly that Kerala University did not have a convocation since last more than 10 years or maybe more. Sir, the number is very large. You limit the number. The award winners, the gold medalists, they can come to the venue. Others may be online, do that, but you must hold the convocation. After about a month, he comes to brief me, giving the details that these many people will be present, these so many people, we will allow them to be online. Fine. Then suddenly this thought comes, now that everybody knows, I'm giving you the details. Then suddenly this thought comes to my mind that instead of, I have already last 3 months I have given convocation address in 3 or 4 universities. I said, this is one of the oldest university of the country, not just of Kerala, of the country. Let us see. Invite the highest dignitary. It will be an honor for Kerala University. So I say that instead of me delivering convocation address, why don't we invite from Delhi? I'm refraining from taking the name or the position. Yes, that will be very good, sir. And then again, you know, this is all while sitting in that meeting. The principal secretary is also there. The vice chancellor is there. And then I say, because when he comes here to deliver the convocation address, listen this carefully. If the university authorities decide as per law, we can also consider conferring honorary degree. And I further clarify, I know for sure that Rashtrapati Bhavan has a policy not to accept honor from our own universities. Syndicate members have turned it down. I said, give me in writing. You know, I will believe when the Vice Chancellor says, syndicate members have turned it down, I will believe it. But from the note, it is clear that despite the direction of the chancellor, he did not call the meeting of the syndicate. Then I, you know, naturally, this thing was bound to come to my mind that somebody else is giving him instructions because he has written, I have informally talked to syndicate members and they have turned it down. I am giving you direction as chancellor to call a meeting. And you are not calling the meeting. I am the appointing authority. I am also the disciplining authority. He is defying me. It's not question of me. Me is not important. He is defying the chancellor. And chancellor has the power to take action. Then naturally, this behavior coincided with what he had earlier told Raj Bhavan, that I am doing so at the instance of so and so. That is the point when I decided that if there is so much interference, that I am asking the Vice Chancellor to call the meeting of the syndicate, and he is not calling the meeting, which he had admitted on the first day when he talked on phone, that so and so is not in favor of doing this thing. Therefore, it cannot be done. Then what inference any other person in my place could have drawn? So I thought, instead of confrontation, I will write to the government that please appoint someone else as chancellor. But now, since then, I have received 3 letters from Chief Minister. In each letter, he says, government has no intention to interfere. Therefore, it is not as if this problem. I only wanted to give them time, because it is absolutely clear that so far I have refrained from taking strong action. Now I feel that this cannot be because we are becoming a laughing stock. The kind of language, Vice Chancellor writing this kind of note, and I tell you something more. For Shankaracharya Sanskrit University, there were 7 applicants. The committee recommended only 1 name. And what they said? Other 6 are not even worthy of being considered for this position. They lack basic qualities. Now all these seven candidates, from which only 1 name has been recommended. People are talking about this, only 1 name has been recommended. You know, 1 name is not important. Important thing is what they have said about other 6 candidates. They lack basic qualifications. And they are professors of 10 years standing in Kerala universities. This is the degradation. To which we have brought the higher education, where Vice Chancellor cannot write 2 correct sentences, where 6 professors of 10 year standing are being described by a committee of which higher education chairman of the Higher Education Council is member, Mr. Rajan Gurukul. You have been sleeping for last 5 years if this is the standard. That's for 6 professors. You are saying that they are not fit, they lack basic qualities. Then what kind of professors we have in Kerala University? Tell me.
Sir, let me clear one thing. The letter of Kerala VC was written in front of you, otherwise he sent it to you.
Naturally, when he is saying to me, I said, give it to me in writing.
Okay.
But naturally, when he comes and tells me about the highest of.
You scholar him, that makes him nervous.
So for argument's sake, he became nervous. He's telling the office, I have given him clear directions to call the meeting of the syndicate. He's not calling the meeting of the syndicate. A nervous person will defy the chancellor like this. Tell me.
Time for the chancellor and the governor to
No, I think I tried to explain exactly that. That first day, this is what he has given in writing. But first day, what he said on telephone was something very loaded. I'm not revealing exact words. I have the exact words with me. I'm not revealing. Before giving this note, he said that he has been told not to call the meeting because so and so are not in favor of doing this thing. This is what I had told you. Otherwise, if that thing had not happened, possibly I would not have gone to the extent of saying that I don't want to function as chancellor. Because I don't want confrontation with the government. But now that government, Chief Minister particularly, they have written 3 letters, still I wanted to give them time.
Sir, when you are saying that you are not in a mood to confront with the government, actually,
confrontation. Confront is a different word. I don't want to have these petty fights with the government.
Yes, that I agree. But then you are actually supporting the illegal activities that you have done in Kannur
no,
City. You have appointed the VC?
Actually, that is not illegal. Now again, let me explain. I am of the clear mind that what was done in the Kannur University was totally irregular. It was against the rules. Why it was against the rules? Because what has been done is, for reappointment, we have relied on the act of the Kannur University. Well, now listen to you. Now listen, please. You have raised the question, therefore now you should listen instead of talking among yourself. For reappointment, they have relied on the provision of the act of the university. For age, they have relied on the provision of the UGC regulations. There is a clear-cut Supreme Court judgment. You can't do this. Either you rely on this or you rely on this. But tell me, if you are in my position, I'm resisting it. Both the letters of the education minister, I resisted. Chief Minister's legal advisor is sitting in the Raj Bhavan and he's insisting that legally it is right. I'm resisting. Suddenly he says, this is an opinion. This is the opinion of the Advocate General. Now tell me, as head of the government, should I not follow, even though I have my own reservations? But when it is finally to the highest legal officer who has been appointed under my signature, shall I refuse to obey his opinion? I can turn it down. I have the right. But that will lead to confrontation. And here, if you had criticized me that for legal opinion you had appointed this man and he was giving you an opinion and you turned it down, then you would have criticized me on that account. After all, when we are doing whatever job we are doing as head of the state, as minister, as chief minister, at that point of time, for legal opinion, we have to depend on, we just don't go by our own reading of the situation. Here, the highest officer, legal officer of the state, my own conscience told me, my own understanding told me that what they are forcing me to bring, not forcing, but bringing pressure on me to do is wrong. But highest legal officer of the state, you see the functioning of the government anywhere.
Sir, if I may ask, when the Advocate General gave you this opinion, did you ever take the legal opinion of any senior?
I'm not supposed to do that. Because remember, Advocate General continues in the office as long as he enjoys my pleasure, governor pleasure. Even the government does not come into it. So it reflects if I am going as head of the state, if I am going to an independent lawyer, then that will be a reflection on my own decision. I have appointed this man as the Advocate General and I am going to you to seek opinion. That is not in accordance with the protocol, in accordance with the procedure of the government. You know, I have been, one thing I tell you with all humility, that I have functioned as a minister since the age of, I was just in my 26. I have experience and I know these protocols.
Sir, one question. Sir, yeah. You were saying that VC were getting some instruction from somewhere.
I'm not saying. He said day before.
So from where did he get that?
I won't tell you, particularly now. I do not want to deepen this crisis, but if the government is saying that they are not talking about the past, they are talking about the future.
So do you think that those instructions were from CM?
Any interference, yeah, yeah.
So will you accept those letters and would you continue?
I want it. In fact, there is no reason for me not to accept. But the consequences, I want them to give time to understand the consequences. Because so far, if I continue, then it will be full of drastic actions. How can you tolerate this state of affairs? I am the appointing authority. It is my responsibility to discipline them. So before that will cause a lot of upsetting. So therefore, I want to give them full time that if you don't want me to go to that extent, then please, still there is time. Bring an ordinance. Appoint some other authority as the chancellor, because now it is not going to continue. Now if I resume my duties, then it will be, time will be full of drastic action.
So your first letter was on the December 8th. The Kerala VC episode provoked you to write this letter?
I have already told you. I think even the day I left here, I said, who is appointed VC here, there? That is not such a serious thing. What totally shook me was on 5th of December, when I see that there is not even any hesitation in saying things which are total violation of the spirit and letter of the Constitution. Article 51(1)(a) says not only to abide by the law and constitution, but show respect to national ideals and institutions. Offices which come in the list of national institutions, how dare you can use language like this? Oh, somebody said Article 51. Governor is not above criticism. Baba, I have not said that I am above criticism. No, I have never said that. I have never claimed. You can criticize me. And respect, showing respect to an institution and criticizing somebody for some action. That is, these are two different things.
Sir, pardon me. I will ask a political question. Will you preparing to contest the vice president election in the coming on this?
I do not know if in India anybody so far has expressed his intention or has made some preparations to fight any of these elections. These elections, you don't take decision. I don't take decision. Nobody knows what is going to happen. This is not fair. To try to find motives, this is not fair.
Because there are some allegations that you are preparing.
By allegation, though, there is allegation, the wise man, government was not saying anything about me. But the loyal opposition was attacking me. You know, like in England, they say, her Majesty's loyal opposition. So here, government was not saying anything. Not a single statement from anybody. opposition was criticized, and what they were saying, now tell me, what they were saying, if the governor has recommended to the vice chancellor some name, then he has violated the law. Please, this is important. You must understand. He has violated the law. Baba, I am the chancellor of the university. Even an ordinary citizen has a right to recommend to any university to consider honoring somebody for some outstanding work.
But there's an impropriety in that, because the Rashtrapati is the appointing authority of governor.
So what?
There's an impropriety there.
Then everything, when the Rashtrapatis are given in office, Bharat Ratna, then everybody is appointed by him? What are you talking about? Out of your head? There are so many honors which have been given to the Rashtrapati. Every single person in this country, any appointment is made in the name of Rashtrapati Bhavan or in the name of governor. What are you talking about?
Have you given it in writing to the university saying that the syndicate should be called in and this proposal?
Whether I have given it in writing or not, the vice chancellor has given it in writing that I had told him.
Functioning under you as vice chancellors, what prevents
action
against them?
No, I have not. Please don't ask me to go into details, but I have told you that I have received these three letters. I have not so far decided, because for me, whatever has happened in Kerala University is too serious. This is a criminal action. So I have not yet decided. In this situation, I cannot continue. This is so far. But I would say that Chief Minister letters, he is assuring again and again that they have no intention to interfere. So if there is a meeting point, if we discuss a meeting point, but why I'm saying so? Because now I'm not going to, I have come to the conclusion that this rot which has set in the higher education, 7 professors applying for the job of vice chancellor, the committee which includes higher education council chairman, they say 6 are not even worthy of, they lack basic qualities, basic qualifications. So this is the state of affairs. Now if I review my decision and I resume my duty, then it will be, I have already told you, I am going to take drastic action.
Sir, one more question, sir. Sorry for coming back to my early question. Do you think that CM was the one who gave instruction to
me? If I wanted to discuss this thing, then why in the first instance I will refuse to reveal what the Vice Chancellor said on the first day? I don't want to complicate the situation.
Whatever
action to rectify the situation, whatever action I could contemplate, I have taken that action. And if I'm satisfied, last 4 days back when I was going, I said, yes, if there is a clear cut assurance that no interference will be there. I said.
Do you believe in the words of the CM?
No, it's not question. It's not question of believing. Law does a law confers power only in the chancellor. Once this, that then I won't have to depend on them, and for that you can trust me. That I won't need anybody's approval. So far, my approach was that I am chancellor because I am governor. Therefore, I had not realized that the state of the higher education has touched this nadir.
So, sir, if you continue as the chancellor, you're getting another chance to rectify the problem you have identified.
I will consider
continuing as a chancellor of the university.
I have not decided so far, but yesterday, in the night when I reached Kerala House in Delhi to come here, then some of the Kerala media persons were there. There also I said that to be fair to the CM, he has written 3 letters, and each letter he is assuring that there will be no interference. But still I wanted to give him time and tell him that you, that now it will be a different chancellor. Why? Because earlier, somehow I did not want to provoke any, not to disturb whatever is going on. But the situation has reached so low that if you do not take action now, then you will be failing in the performance of your duties. Forget about everything. The chairman of the Higher Education Council, the vice chairman of the State Planning Board, they are member of that selection committee. They are saying out of 7 professors of 10 years standing in Kerala universities who applied for the post of vice chancellor, we are recommending 1 only because other 6 lack basic qualifications. How come they became professors if they lack basic qualifications? I ask you. It can happen only when there is too much political interference.
Can't you correct these interference?
I don't know. I don't know. But now I will, if matter is resolved and I resume my duty, that will be my total focus.
By resuming your duty, can't you correct the government?
No.
That's the best way to correct the government.
You protect the universities because governments come and go. You know, always remember, world over, it is not Kerala. World over, the universities, it stinks in the nostrils of those who believe in the independence of academics, autonomy of the universities. Any interference by the executive stinks in the nostrils of those. People, even in developed countries, ministers cannot dare to interfere in the functioning of the university. And universities can bloom, can really develop, can come into their own only when they are allowed to grow independently.
Sir, one doubt. Even if the Advocate General has given their very clear advice, maybe his opinion, on the appointment of a vice-chancellor, but if the governor has any doubt on it, or if you think that it was not right, you could have resisted it.
Okay, right. We appoint Advocate General or Attorney. System provides for this highest authority. Only when we have doubts in our mind. Already so many vice chancellors I have appointed. He did not give advice. I did not see, even in this matter, I did not seek advice. But finally, when the opinion comes, you have reposed trust in him. That whenever I will be in doubt, I will seek your opinion and then I will go by that. Otherwise, what is the use of having? It's a different matter if you ask me the question that the when I appointed him, I reposed that trust in him. You, in fact, what if I were in your place, I would ask this question whether you still have trust in him.
So that is my second question.
That I will let you know in 2-3 days.
Sir,
hey, sir, give me a little more time.
We'll come back.
The governor, Advocate General can, article of the Constitution is absolutely clear. He can continue in office only as long as he enjoys pleasure of the governor. So the question, if I were in your place, I will ask the question that after having misled me, he has misled. Why he has misled? If somebody is not pricking his conscience, he will write to me that now I don't want to appear for you in the High Court. Instead of that, he has gone to the press and said he won't appear for me. Now I have made arrangement for, now I have made a non-official lawyer to appear in the High Court. But he has gone public. So the right question would have been, whether he still enjoys my confidence?
Yes.
I will let you know. No. Give me some more time. Because the moment I say something, then, you know, then yes. So I won't say right
now. Another subject. Allowed to questions have arisen about the feasibility of the proposed silver line project in the state.
I won't. I really.
You ask the government for clarification because people are concerned.
If I receive representation, definitely I will. Definitely I will.
One
yes. You know, I don't look at things like this. It's only inexperience and the intra-party struggle. They used me only to settle the accounts among themselves. So I don't take it that way.
Sir,
I don't.
Sir, one more clarification. You said that you sought AG's legal opinion, and after getting AG's legal opinion, you signed that appointment order without any doubt, right?
No. I still had my doubts. But we appoint, the government appoints law officers. When we have doubts, then that is why the legal officers are appointed. I still had my reservations. And now I have even strong reservations. Why I have strong reservations? That he is saying to the press, he is not even saying to me. He is saying to the press that he won't appear on my behalf. He has been appointed by me, and he is saying he won't appear on my behalf. It means somewhere his conscience is pricking.
So if you think that AG misled you, right?
AG?
Misled you.
No, AG clearly misled me. AG clearly misled me, and I have not come to this conclusion because what he has written. I have come to this conclusion that on my behalf he does not. Action I have taken on based on his opinion, and he is saying I won't appear in the High Court. It means he finds his own opinion indefensible.
So if you are so much clear about that, what you did in Kannur VC appointment, why don't you rectify it, sir?
After that, something more serious happened. If you are suffering from headache, and God forbid, corona takes over, you will address headache or you will address corona? I'm asking. Something very serious has happened.
So we addressing all...
I will address... If I am satisfied, and I'm saying, in fairness to Chief Minister, he has already written to me 3 letters. So, but I wanted to give them time to realize the consequences that if I resume... It is not going to be calm waters now. It will be, I will, right from day one, I will be on the course, on course correcting mission.
So you were saying something about clear-cut assurance from government to resume in your position.
No.
That assurance includes these recommendations, acceptance of these recommendations for honoring the president.
No. I have already. You don't listen to me when I.
When I speak.
In fact, media people generally, they are more interested in their questions than the answers. I have told you, Rashtrapati Bhavan. I have told the Vice Chancellor that Rashtrapati Bhavan has a clear-cut policy not to accept any honor from any university. But if our authorities take a decision, then I will go personally, try to persuade him, because I feel that Kerala University is one of the oldest universities among first 14 or 15 universities. So this though, I had to, a new exercise would have started. And I thought that after 2-3 meetings, I would be able to persuade. Rashtrapati Bhavan has a clear-cut policy. They don't accept honor from any university. And after this ugly episode, there is no way if I do my best arguments, my best everything, even then they won't touch it with a barge pole.
Sir, thank you.